So, Brian Eno, welcome.
Hello.
Very good to see you. Slightly relieved to see you. Because
yes,
truth
be known. An emergency getting here. I completely forgot.
Yeah.
Actually, and I was sitting in my studio, tootling away.
Yeah.
And suddenly, I looked at my phone and there were 96 messages for me, and I thought, somebody wants me, and I suddenly remembered why.
Right, OK. You said this, that you don't make a habit of this.
No, I'm very punctual normally.
Right, OK. So we feel honoured that we're the first thing you've ever forgotten. And before that, I mean, it's quite interesting in sort of what you spend your time doing. You've got a kind of doo-wop a cappella club that meets occasionally.
Yeah, we meet about once a week.
As much as that. That's,
called the Elgin Marvels.
The Elgin Marvels, good.
Yeah. Sometimes we even meet twice in a week.
Right.
Yeah, so it's a loose group, but there's a sort of core of five of us.
Right.
And we sing, yeah, mostly doo-wop songs or blues songs, actually, as well.
Yeah, yeah.
House of the Rising Sun, we do.
Right, okay.
Every Time You Say Goodbye, we do that one.
Really? Yeah, yeah. And, I mean, is this does doo-wop your first love? Was that when you kind of... Because this leads us quite nicely onto the new album, Another Day on Earth, because it is Brian Eno's return to singing, at least in public, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
So was doo-wop where it started? Was that what you wanted to be, in a doo-wop group, first
doo-wop
of all?
Doo-wop was the first music I really loved.
Was it?
Yeah. It was the first music I heard that I thought was completely alien. I didn't know where it came from.
Yeah.
You know, I was about 7 or 8 growing up in rural Suffolk, and there were these American air bases nearby.
Right.
So there were lots of airmen driving around in these huge cars.
Right.
And there was a lot of doo-wop around, stuff that you never heard on the radio here.
Yeah.
Just never got to England, this stuff. And I thought, I wonder what these people look like. I had no idea what sort of beings made music like this, you know. And those people with the voice that go...
Right. Is that the bit you do?
That's I often do that.
In Blue Moon. Bum-a-da-bum.
Yes.
The Marcel.
I can do that part.
Yeah.
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 I used to do the falsetto, but I can't reach it anymore.
No. Right, OK. I mean, but you're back to doing an album of songs. What made you go back to songs? Because, of course, more recently, apart from the production, people have associated you with the sort of ambient and instrumental work. So what made you sing again? Or were these bits of songs and fragments that you'd had lying around for ages and just pulled it all together?
Well, I like songs and I like singing.
Mm.
For a long while, I didn't want to do it because I felt that in popular music or rock music, the song is so identified with the singer. You know, it's always assumed that you are the person singing this song.
Right.
That it's an extension of your personality. And the last thing I'm interested in, actually, is selling my personality to people.
Mm.
The way I feel about songwriting is that you're like a playwright who invents a scene, a scenario, and then invents a character who exists in it.
Mm.
And I want the singing to be like that. I don't want it to be me. I want it to be someone I've invented.
Right.
And that suddenly started to become possible again in the last few years because there were some new technologies for dealing with how voices can be treated.
Right.
You can now do things with your voice, so you can change sex, you can sing in completely different octaves, you can become robotic, you can sound even more fragile than any human ever has before.
Mm.
So suddenly the idea of singing again started to seem interesting because I could very clearly create different personas there.
So it was more the actual sound of your voice, because I have heard you kind of talking about the challenge of writing lyrics, because obviously, like, you know, with machines have made music so accessible and computers that everybody can knock it. Things that would have taken, you know, a truckload of equipment or a massive state-of-the-art studio only 10 years ago, you can now do on something you buy from Argos.
Yes.
But there isn't an equivalent
and
device.
And it sounds like it.
So, but there isn't an equivalent device which will spew out lyrics.
That's right. And I've been working on this problem for some time. Because my experience of having produced a lot of albums and seeing how bands work is that usually the real bottleneck is the lyrics.
Mm.
So making the music is all fun and easy and everyone's got loads of ideas, and it always ends up, it comes down to some guy sitting in the corner with everyone glaring at him, and he's sort of scratching out lyrics and going and trying them. They don't sound quite right, and he's back again writing them out again. So there's a very funny story, actually, of my friend Dan Lanois, the producer, who who got so frustrated with Peter Gabriel's attempts to write a song that he nailed him into the vocal booth and said, you can't come out till you've finished the lyrics.
Right, yeah. And he did it. He had to then at that point.
I think he did then finish,
right.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
He has lived to tell the tale anyway.
Do the lyrics... I mean, you never sang in Roxy Music, really, did he? I mean,
only backing vocals.
Right, yeah, but so, you know, what made you start when you came out? I mean, I suppose you had to, a solo artist. I suppose you were forced to at that point, weren't you, really?
But I had written songs before.
Yeah.
Before I joined Roxy, I had written quite a few songs.
Yeah.
So, and I was used to singing. I liked singing, and I have a very strange voice. You know, I wouldn't pretend I'm a classic singer in any way, but I have a voice that I can control quite well. It's sort of, it's like a fine engineering pencil rather than a big beautiful paintbrush, you know.
Right, okay.
It's a sort of 6H voice. I always think of it as.
Shall we hear you in action?
Sure.
I was thinking of playing How Many Worlds. Do you fancy that? Is there anything we need to know about that, or should we just let the lyric wash over us?
Yeah, you can. Yes, this is one with probably the least affected voice on the album. So this is almost my natural voice, I would say here.
Okay. All right. Brian Eno from the new album Another Day on Earth, which is out now, and this is How Many Worlds.
Thinking of a world in the light of the sun, and all the many lives that were ever begun, ever begun. Our little world turning in the blue. As each day goes, there's another one new. Another one new. How many people will we feed today? How many lips will we kiss today? sun and all the many lives that were ever begun.
How Many Worlds from Another Day on Earth, from Brian Eno's new album. You're saying that's kind of a conceit because it's not really a proper song.
Well, I think quite a lot of the songs on this album are really alibis for long instrumental sections. So there's a bit of singing so that you think, oh, this is a song, fine, I know what they're like.
Talking about lyrics before, Bernard Hepworth has been on. Incidentally, if you want to email us and anything you want to ask Brian, then please do. The usual email address applies. If you're looking at us on the webcam, I presume the webcam is on the studio in Manchester, looking at an empty room. but because we're in London tonight, we are not on tape. We are here. And we're doing this live, so you can email us. Bernard Hepworth has been on. He says, I was very interested to see your review of Before and After Science in Word magazine, which I was telling you about. He said, however, I was most disappointed that you didn't mention the track Backwater, which is a great song, in your review, which I believe is one of the few album tracks where the word sausage is used seamlessly within a lyric. This is from Bernard Hepworth, live president of the World Sausage Association. So people do appreciate these things.
I should say that's probably the only pop song where the word heuristic has also been used.
Almost certainly.
And logistics is in that song as well.
Might be in a busted tune.
With logistics, yeah.
Alan in Leeds says, didn't Brian go to Japan? And has that affected his musical taste? Because I was going to ask you about this album. You said, All the Lives. And there's a kind of global theme on this, you know. Yeah. I mean, is that a global perspective? Because you've become a bit kind of dissatisfied with the notion of simply a national identity, haven't you? You're kind of disenfranchised from that notion in a way.
Yeah, I don't really think I have a national identity. I was talking about this with some people the other night. I said, what would you say first? Are you a Londoner, a British person, an English person, or a European? Mm. And I think, actually, I would say, first of all, I'm a European.
Would you? Yeah.
And last, I would say English, actually.
Why?
It's the least clear as an identity for me. I can understand what being a European means, as opposed to being an American or an Asian, for example.
Yeah.
I can understand sort of what being British means. But English, I don't know what that means any longer.
Mm.
This little island.
And so is that one of the themes of the album? Because, like, you know, how many worlds and little lives all over
yes,
the world connected?
Yes, that's right.
Is that what sort of binds it together?
Well, I suppose it's also the kind of thing you start thinking about when you reach a certain age of... That particular song says, how many worlds can we ever see? How many people can we ever be?
Mm.
And it's sort of a question about how many other possibilities of life you didn't take advantage of or that could have happened instead of the one that you particularly took.
Well, that's an interesting theme, which we'll get back to a bit later on. And I was going to ask you, are you still a willful non-musician? We heard the first track, Editions of You, which has got the wildest kind of synth solo on there, which presumably you were still operating with a joystick and no keyboard at that point.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Audio generated. Are you still a willful non-musician? I mean, working in music for so long, wouldn't that be disingenuous? You must have learnt to play a bit by now.
It's very hard to defend yourself against craft for this long, but I have succeeded.
Never had a piano lesson or a guitar. Still dabbling and experimenting and willfully, being a willful non-musician.
I think so, because, you know, there are a lot of people who cover that territory.
Mm.
But the interesting thing is to come to these new instruments, which synthesizers and all the other things are, with some kind of different intention. What else can I do with this rather than duplicate the music that we've already heard before?
Right.
Because when I started playing synthesizers, most people thought that they were sort of electronic organs with a few new sounds, you know, a few funny sounds.
Yeah.
Well, I couldn't play an electronic organ anyway, so I thought, I just like the funny sound part of it.
Yeah.
Forget the organ bit.
Yeah. No, I think you're right. And also, great music in rock and roll has never been made by a band consisting entirely of great musicians,
yes,
with the exception of Led Zeppelin. Right, okay. Anyway, Brian Eno is with us tonight, and you know, any questions and loads more to talk about later on. We'll go up to the news with the bird. That's the Verve and Bittersweet Symphony, which we will play for all the HNC electrical engineering students at Liverpool Community College who are sweating to finish their excitement so they can go out on the razzle on Monday. That's for from Dan, Built for Electronics, the man. Right, okay. And also play it for Neil in Buxton. And we said before that no music had ever been created by a band consisting entirely of great musicians, the exception, Brian Eno, being Led Zeppelin. But Neil in Buxton saying, I agree about Led Zeppelin, but what about Yes and Pink Floyd? You see, here, I think this holds up the theory, because Yes, apart from Roundabout...
I agree with you.
Rick Wakeman's a great friend of ours.
I know where you're going.
But he's not very good, is he?
I'm with you.
I mean, he's very good, but he's not. I didn't think they made a lot of great music yet.
How about Soft Machine?
Soft Machine? Was there not some willful non-musicianship in that band?
Well, the singer, Kevin Ayers, was sort of a non-musician, but the band were very, very, very good players. Yes, I have to give you that. Kevin Ayers was sort of claimed to be a non-musician.
And Pink Floyd, who made some glorious records, and it'd be great to see them back together for this, you know, Live Aid thing. But, I mean, I don't think even Nick Mason would claim to be a great drummer, would it, really? I mean, you don't need a great drummer in Pink Floyd. It would spoil it. If you had Yes's drummer in Pink Floyd flying around and playing too much, you don't want it.
No.
And Roger Waters, his great bass line is, we don't need no education, donk. Isn't it? That's his great bass line. But one note there.
Donk is what you want from bass players.
It is. What else?
They're donkeys.
I mean, that's if you know, more than four strings on a bass, you know you're in trouble, Brian, don't you?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. I always distrust those great big things with five strings on them.
I mean, you know, four is too many.
I saw a six-string bass the other day.
I mean, I'm told, you know Cheap Trick, the group Cheap Trick?
Yeah.
12-string bass.
No.
And Mike in Bristol said, is it true that Brian Eno created the Microsoft Windows tune?
Yes, I did, for the Windows 95, I think it was.
So, do you get paid every time someone turns on a computer?
I really wish I did, because it's estimated that was in 2 billion computers at one point.
Yeah, I'm sure
no,
it was.
It was a buyout. They just paid me for doing it, and that was
I hope it was the right amount. Nick in Hove in Sussex says, read the place of sausages in popular music. It's all these running debates going on. I'm not sure whether this counts, but in 1896, Gilbert and Sullivan's last work together, The Grand Duke, included the sausage roll song. Does the addition of pastry put it out of contention?
I'm glad there's some serious research going on.
It is. It's an intellectual exercise for you tonight, which takes us neatly into the next thing, which I just want to... I'm going to think and do this on all guests now, the name game test, just because I think it reveals things. Because Andy from Swindon has been on, said, my Star Wars name is Marina Simvastatin or something. What's Brian's? Because we can do this now. Your porn star name, which we're doing this on a nightly basis, your first pet and your mother's maiden name.
Yeah, it's Tubby Buslow. Which I would actually be proud to be known as Tubby Buslow.
Absolutely.
I think it's a name that you can't argue with, really.
I think it's great. Have you still got your large erotica collection ever growing?
Ever growing.
A Star Wars name doesn't work for you because you've never owned a car.
No, I've never owned a car, and I can't remember the last medicine I took. So.
Well, that's all right then. Your Ramones name is easy because you just put Brian in front of Ramone for your Ramones name. Brian. we're sort of spoilt for choice with your romantic novelist name, because romantic novelist name is your middle name and the street on which you live.
Oh, my God.
And I mean, there are so many of your middle name.
Oh, my God.
Do you live on a street or a name of a lane or...?
Well, in London I do, yes.
Right.
Pembridge.
It's going to work. And
he's excited, I can see. He's getting moist now.
One of your middle names would be...
Well, I've got Peter, George, or St. Jean-le-Baptiste de La Salle. Which would you like?
See, we're looking for a romantic novelist name. There's one contained within your name straight away. But George Pembridge.
George Pembridge. Or St. John. You could have St. John Pembridge.
St. John Pembridge.
I think that's good.
Excellent. There's a man in a smoking jacket.
Yes,
right.
St. John Pembridge.
Right, indeed.
Laughter in the dark.
And the last one here, because I asked you for this, the American president, when you were born, and the last seaside resort in the UK that you visited.
OK, so I think That's Eisenhower and Hove.
You see, this is for your West Indian cricketer name. So Eisenhower Hove is now opening the batting for the West Indies. And Andrew in Essex has been on. He said he came out rather disappointedly as Regan Southend. But he was online at a Sheffield Wednesday website, and they all had a go at it. And also he found that he was in the company of Eisenhower Ullapool, Clinton Bude and Carter Bridlington, who are all considered for selection in the next West Indies cricket squad. But we'll have Tiff Merritt and then more from Brian Eno. That's not it, is it? That is. That is. I'll play that for Dave, who says, I'm going to now have to listen to your show and listen again because our factory has just been hit by lightning and everything is cut out. Nice. I believe there are some storms coming across tonight just to put Glastonbury under a couple of inches of mud, which would be traditional and nice. Tiff Merritt and Good Hearted Man. Brian Eno is with us tonight, avidly signing copies of the new album, which we're going to give away. We need to think of a question, don't we? We don't have to do it right now, if you want. We'll chew on it, shall we?
I think we should, yes. Yes, I mean, we want to have a difficult question.
We do. Then it won't.
Not just any old question.
No, we don't want anybody winning these. And then,
for instance, we could say, we know some one person knows the number. What did Stafford Beer do?
Yes, who could say that? An accomplice of yours. Well, we'll try that. Shall we say, how many copies of the album have you got there?
I think there's six.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So we'll see. We'll see how many right answers we get on the
Stafford Beer.
Who was Stafford Beer, and what was his connection to Brian Eno? And if we've not got rid of them all on that question, then we'll try something else a little bit later on. We started off with a bit of Roxy Music tonight, which was the first time most of us encountered you, which is, you know, great fun. All that sort of glam and dressing up, a serious band, but dressing up, because a lot of rock bands around that time were like sort of Free, who were great, and I love Free, but were kind of, like, you know, looked like they'd come to fix the plumbing a bit. You didn't.
Well, no, we were very clear that we want to be different from that kind of hippie idea of we're so lost in the music that we can't even put together a good pair of jeans to wear.
Right, yeah. You know, yeah.
We're so into what we're doing that we can't be bothered to comb our hair.
Yeah.
So we really want, sort of harking back to an earlier tradition of rock music, like Little Richard and people like that.
Showmen.
Who were showmen, basically. Mm. So we wanted to take the idea of showmen and sort of push it forward into the 21st century.
So you're at the same time kind of futuristic and yet retro.
That's right. That was very much the idea.
Yeah.
How to be, sort of borrow from the past and imagine how it would look in the future, you know.
Yeah.
How would people be looking if they were playing music on another planet or in another era, you know.
Yeah. How did you feel when you went on the old grey whistle test and our dear friend Bob Harris was made it plain that he was underwhelmed considerably? Because I was watching it on telly at home and I was incensed on your behalf. And although, you know, Bob, possibly the world's nicest and most gentlemanly gentleman, you know, on that occasion, you know, I mean, he just sort of mumbled through his beard, if that's the future of rock and roll, you can keep it.
Is that what he said?
Or words to that effect. I don't know, I mean, did it bother you at the time? Or?
We sort of had our kind of a revenge, because there was a club that everybody used to go to called the Speakeasy.
Yes.
And it was always very dark. And not two nights after that, Bob Harris was crossing the club and tripped down the stairs. And it was as though we'd hexed him.
Right.
But I don't remember him, actually. I can't remember that he said anything particularly bad about us. He obviously wasn't that enthusiastic.
No. No.
You can't like everything, can
no,
you?
No, I admire his candour, in retrospect. But at the time, were you not tempted by the Roxy Music reunion? Because I went to see that and it was great, and it did, like, you know, all remake, remodel and everything they started with, and it made those of us of a certain vintage, you know, inordinately happy. And they were playing sort of samples of your synth solos from Left of Stage, where a very attractive-looking blonde woman with a fiddle was doing the honors for you.
But there would have been the same thing then.
It's very similar, very similar. But I mean, there was an enormous amount of goodwill towards Roxy getting back together, and there would have been even more so had you been at the side of the stage with your joystick and small telephone exchange. Were you not tempted?
No, I wasn't tempted really.
Because you had been working with Brian on that Frantic album just before that, hadn't you?
Yeah. No, I like I like all of those people very much, and I like the band. I just don't fancy doing something again, you know.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem very exciting to me. It takes a lot of time to do a show, you know. It's not as if you just sort of turn up there one evening and join in.
Yeah.
You have to do a lot of rehearsals.
Well, you probably could the bits you do. I mean, you know.
In fact, I could probably send a lookalike, couldn't I?
Nobody leave would a know. Gap. Brian, you know, 8 bars of burble from stage left. You know, I mean, it'd probably be all right.
Probably would, actually. or, as I said, I could send someone who sort of looked like me.
Yeah. I mean, presumably, that you know, I mean, we don't want to go through the whole Roxy Music story. There was a tension between what Brian Ferry wanted it to be and what you wanted it to be, and you finished up leaving. But was the kind of the tension something that you learnt to kind of enjoy, because that took things in a different direction? I'm kind of leaning on to the oblique strategies and embracing things that happen by accident. So things that can seem negative actually turn out to be fairly positive, and that goes also back to what you were talking about, the chance of the chances on which life hinges, really, which direction you go in.
Well, yes, I think, first of all, it sort of rather dignifies the argument between us to say it was musical difference, because it never is musical difference. It's always somebody's getting more attention than me, or vice versa, and I'm pissed off about it. And, you know, we were two young men in our 20s or whatever it was, and it was an ego issue, really. Yeah. It wasn't really to do with the direction of the music of the band, and nobody was to blame for it or anything like that. It was just time for something else to happen.
Yeah.
And I'm very glad it did. I think, to tell you the truth, my favourite Roxy album is the one they made immediately after I left. I think that's a fantastic record, the best record they made, the third one.
So was that Stranded, is it?
I can't remember.
Was that Stranded? The one with Song for Europe on it?
Had Mother of Pearl on it and Song for Europe. Yeah.
I think that's Stranded, isn't it? Yeah, the one before Country Life.
Probably
Country Life is
yes.
Fourth, isn't it? And then Siren, is that right?
That's right, yes.
Okay, yeah.
And I thought that was a fabulous record. And probably if I'd been in the band then, it wouldn't have been such a good record.
Right.
It was a more committed, clear picture of where they were.
Yeah.
And on the other hand, of course, I left and then I made my own music, which I certainly wouldn't have made in that band. So it was fine in the end. Right. Everything was fine.
Let's hear something from that era, just after you'd left the band, because, I do love these first sort of swathe of classic Brian Eno vocal albums. I was sport for choice, really, but I did think we'd have I'll Come Running from Another Green World, which is a great pop song.
Mm-hmm.
And you went in the studio with no songs, didn't you? Didn't you just sort of make it all up once you got in there? Again, embracing this risk and sort of taking a chance with things.
Yeah, that's very much what I wanted to do. I more and more worked on the idea that the studio was a place where you made music rather than where you recorded music. You know, the old idea was that you had the songs written and you went in and the studio was just a way of getting them onto a record. But I thought the studio was the most creative place that there was. There were all these new possibilities which people weren't using very much at the time, because they are now. But so I thought, I won't bother to write anything. I'm just going... It's always better if it originates from the studio itself. And so I went in with nothing, and with just a few ideas about, you know, could you record a song where the microphones were constantly in motion, for example. That was one of the things we did. And I was working in the studio then. It had a very high ceiling. It was an old church. And we, on one song, we recorded everything with the microphone swinging as a huge pendulum back and forth. That's on that same record, actually.
Is it? Right. Yeah. It's not this track.
It's not that track, no. Right. No, it's Zawinul Lava.
The name
of the track, I think.
Okay, right. But anyway, out of all these chances came gems, and this is certainly one of them.
We're silhouettes by the light. and I'll come running to tie your shoe. I'll come running to tie your shoe. I'll come running to tie your shoe. I'll come running to tie your shoe.
Just trying to work out what year it is between us, though.
I think it's 75.
You reckon?
1975,
okay.
Yeah.
Right, that's from Another Green World by Brian Eno. Yeah. I'll Come Running to Tie Your Shoe with Robert Fripp on guitar. We'll talk lots more to Brian Eno later. If you're waiting for the easier question to win copies of his album, I can only disappoint you, I'm afraid, because we've got enough takers on the other question relating to Stafford Beer, which we will get to in a short while. These are Teenage Fan Club. This is one of their own tunes, actually, but they're coming on in session on Wednesday the 29th, which will be next Wednesday, won't it, right, to play some stuff off the new album. I Need Direction, Teenage Fan Club from the album Howdy, which came out in 2000. They'll be playing live on the programme next Wednesday. We will play that for Eisenhower Bogner Regis, who is going into hospital. tomorrow. So
that doesn't sound like any like a cricket.
Well, it's Julian Chesterfield then is probably better. So best of luck in hospital tomorrow. And also for Nick, it's for future reference, I think the song that I mentioned, that last Gilbert and Sullivan opera, The Grand Duke, was about a society of anarchists whose secret sign is the consumption of a solid roll. The show did not last long.
I used to be an anarchist, you know.
Did you? Did you eat a sausage roll as a sort of card carrying member?
No, we didn't have a sausage roll insignia, but I used to sell a magazine called The Anarchist on the streets of Ipswich when I was 14.
Did you?
Yes, because I was very persuaded by anarchism at the time. Right. And in fact, I still am, actually.
Yeah. Right, okay. Then you're going to start another, then. You're going to get an issue two coming out now.
After a high. If I can save up for the sausage rolls.
Now then, I think you might like this record. We played it last week, and a lot of people asked what it was, because there's a kind of good DIY spirit to this. It's called Honolulu Rock and Roll, which is by Kitty, Daisy and Lewis, who come from Kentish Town, just up the road from where we are in central London tonight. They're siblings. Kitty's 11, Daisy's 16 and Lewis is 14. And they were inspired to play Hawaiian music because their granddad had a Hawaiian guitar. And Lewis made his own lap steel with a piece of 4x2 and 6-inch nails and everything. And, and I think this is just a great record. So Kitty, Daisy and Lewis and Honolulu Rock and Roll.
They do the Honolulu Rock and Roll. Dance, swing, a little buzz, they love to
lovely.
It's fantastic, isn't it?
Really lovely, yeah.
Utterly charming, I think. Kitty, Daisy and Lewis and Honolulu Rock and Roll. And that is released now. It's on Oof Records. It seems entirely appropriate. It's out now. It's on 7-inch vinyl only.
And the drummer is 11 years old. You know, that's fantastic.
Great, isn't it? Yeah, we like that a lot. Brian Eno is with us tonight. We'll talk more on his music off the new album very shortly. But this is Robert Plant. A lovely single from Robert Plant and the Strange Sensation from the Mighty Rearranger album. That's out now. That is All the King's Horses. While we're talking about competitions, we might as well put this one to bed to win copies of Brian's new album, Another Day on Earth. Brian Eno is with us tonight, if you've just tuned in. Ian Kendrick actually emailed to say, I know that Eno was influenced by Stafford Beer. Right? And so you said, which I mentioned to you earlier, which is why you set the question, Stafford Beer was?
Shall I say who?
Yeah, of course.
He was a cybernetician. He was sort of the father of British cybernetics and a very influential thinker for me. He influenced a lot of the music that I did, in fact.
Right, okay. Well, there's sufficient people who knew that to win copies of the album, so congratulations to Michael Mabel in Bromyard in Herefordshire. Paul Samuel is also a woman. Tony Martin in Halifax. Andrew Charters in Home Firth. And also Sean Winder. Somewhere or other. He's a professor of cybernetics specialising in holistic management and organisational transformation as well as a painter or a poet.
Well done. Right. Well, okay. Congratulations for everyone who knew that, I must say. I'm very impressed.
Signed copies of the new album will be coming your way. It's funny, because when I first read about Roxy Music and sort of, you know, read your name, your endless name, which you did, and you know, your art school background, and heard you talk, I assumed that you were kind of more or less, if not aristocracy, then certainly landed gentry. And yet it was quite a shock to find out you came from a long line of postmen.
I refer to them as communication specialists.
Well, of course. I thought you might.
Yeah. My father was a postman, and my grandfather and my great-grandfather even were postmen.
So where did all these names come from, then? I mean, the full name again?
Catholics. Right. Catholicism. You know, you get all sorts of weird things from Catholicism, guilt, perversion, and long names, basically.
And did you? Was your father disappointed that you didn't carry on the family tradition of being a postman?
Well, I remember calling my mother when I was about 35, after I'd bought them a house and so on, and I called her up and she said, "Do you know, son? Do you think you'll ever get a real job?" And I said, "Well, I think this is sort of what I'm going to do, really." And she said, "Well, you know, if you ever wanted to, I'm sure you could get a really good job at the post office."
So they did, Bonnie. But wasn't your granddad, though, a postman? I mean, he kind of had a musical impact on you. Didn't he build this, like, extraordinary organ, sort of incorporated into the house?
Well, my grandfather repaired mechanical musical instruments, which, of course, were the synthesizers of the early 19th and 20th century.
Yeah.
And he used to recondition organs, but he would keep all of the pipes from the broken pipes and, you know, fix them up. And he built in his chapel that he lived in, a converted chapel, he had a 600 pipe organ with pipes everywhere, like behind the stove and up in the toilets and everywhere. Wherever he could fit a pipe in, he'd stick a pipe. And when he played the organ, it was an all-round 3D experience.
Yeah. Wait, it was him who, in fact, was the architect of ambient music and not you?
I'm afraid to say that's true, yes. I took the credit, but he did the work.
But that was accidental as well, wasn't it? We're talking about accidents. So wasn't that you were, the ambient stuff, wasn't that you were listening to something through a broken hi-fi? One speaker was broken, he only heard part of it, and you were so ill you couldn't get out of bed, and it blended with the bird song, and you thought, hello?
Yeah, well, it blended with the rain, actually.
Rain, yeah.
So I was listening to something that just wasn't turned up loud enough, and because I was ill, I couldn't get out to get out of bed to turn it up, and so I just had to accept it, and I thought, this is a very interesting new way of listening to music as part of your landscape rather than as a sort of something stamped on top of the landscape, you know?
Yeah.
And so I started listening in that way and thinking, there's a place for a new kind of music and a new way of listening.
Because, you
know, whenever there's a new kind of music, there's a new way of listening as well. That's what it means, really.
But, I mean, that was kind of, you know, something you originated. And in a way, you know, people may be less grateful for this in certain quarters. You kind of originated stadium rock. Because, look, here's my theory, right? You two were a highly proficient and a really good four-piece rock and roll band, uh-huh. and still are. Now, then you get to the Joshua Tree, and Anton Corbijn's photographs place them in this epic landscape, mm-hmm. and along comes Brian Eno and thinks, yeah, but if we could just put this rock and roll in this epic tonal sweep and incorporate it, what would you have then? Stadium Rock was born, and it was great then.
Good theory.
Yeah, right or wrong.
Good theory. I think there were stadium rockers before. But
yeah, no, they were playing big gigs, but you know what I mean? This kind of rock and roll band, but with this great kind of soundscape surrounding it and enveloping it and making it seem mm-hmm. more epic. I mean, Pink Floyd had done a bit of that, to be mm-hmm. sure. But
yeah, but I'm quite happy to take credit for any kind of mistake, really. Any kind of wrong direction in culture.
But, I mean, is that the way you intended it? Is that the way you saw it in any way like that? Because the music matched the photos perfectly in that, you know, that so it seems quite a watershed, that album, in retrospect.
Well, what I always thought when I listened to music, I always wanted to think that the music was going on right to the horizon and beyond it. So I always wanted to think that I wasn't just hearing four people standing in a room playing, but I was hearing a whole landscape. And I was even aware that there were parts of the landscape that I wasn't hearing, that were outside of my hearing range.
Yeah.
So I just want the music to feel big in that sort of geographical sense, you know, as if it extended as far as you could hear.
Yeah.
And so that was, I think, what we were trying to do there, was to try to make a music that just sounded like it was a world, not a band, but a world, really.
Which is why it works in a big stadium, isn't it?
In a big stadium,
it?
Yes.
It's right, it sort of reaches you no matter where you sit in there. And I mean, but that's a kind of interesting thing, because like how you experiment with music, which on the one hand is kind of a left-field activity, mm-hmm. like kind of, I guess, you know, high fashion or something eventually influences the high street. Yeah. I guess that kind of dabbling on the left field eventually becomes a mainstream accepted practice.
Well, it always does. I think that's where ideas come from, you know. Yeah. They always come from someone thinking, I wonder what would happen if you did this. Wouldn't that be funny to do that? Let's see what that would feel like. And they do it, and it sounds kind of interesting. And after a while, other people think, do you know, that sounds more interesting than what we're doing right now. Yeah. Why don't we try a bit of that as well?
Yeah.
So I think things just veer in a direction, really.
Let's have another track from the new album anyway, Another Day on Earth, and you've picked And Then So Clear, which it sort of goes back to how we started talking about shifting the quality of the voice, really.
Okay, so this is a strange voice sound, and I'll dedicate this to two people currently on the M1, Ken and Nick.
Right. Okay. Ken and Nick, this is for you.
Space, we fail to fall.
And then so clear, Brian Eno from Another Day on Earth. Loads more we could do because there are two other important areas that we haven't dealt with, which it's too late now because I'm going to play one very short record before we finish. Mark Porter wanted to know about you working with Paul Simon on his new album, which you are, which is a whole other set of stories. And even more importantly, Steve in Sheffield wanted to know about the therapeutic benefits of drinking one's own urine, as described in your diary, which you published. But those will have to wait till next time.
Yes, there's a lot to talk about on that subject.
Okay. All right, Brian Eno, thanks a lot for coming in.
Thank you very much.
Though you nearly forgot us, we're glad you didn't. Just before we go, this is a very quick record from Field Music.